like thanking you all very much for coming out on this horrendous evening and coming here to the Dean's Centre. Can I particularly thank Ibrahim and Mohammed from the Dean's Centre for extending their hospitality to us this evening, this constituency committee meeting, and also for the lovely food that you've put on. Much appreciated. A bit later on in the agenda, we're going to hear of some of the work that's being done here, and most of us, particularly the councillors who work there, know what an important part you're playing now in bringing the community together in Birkenhead, and we thank you for that. I'm going to start with declarations of interest. Have any of the members got any declarations of interest?
I'll be clear, not prejudicial interest in any of the debates straight to the work of the agenda as a board director.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else? Okay, thank you very much. We've got apologies for absence.
Sorry, second. As a possible member of the planning committee on the Hoy Lake Golf Resort, I will not be expressing an opinion as I attend the planning committee. No, fine.
And that goes for anybody else who's on planning, which I think that applies to you too. Apologies for absence. I've had apologies from Councillor Stuart Kelly, Councillor Bill Davis, Councillor Brian Kenny, and Councillor George Davis. Are there any others? Can I also say, while I think on, that we've got Mark and Nicola Pallias and Ben Harrison here today from Tranmere Rovers, and thank you very much for coming and showing an interest in the work of the committee. It's nice to have you here. I'm sure that everybody else is very important as well. I don't want to single anybody out. The more astute of you will have noticed that I'm not George Davis. I'm Catherine Warren McLaughlin, and I think it would be helpful if we just do a quick run round of the introduction from the top table. Jill, do you want to tell me who you are and what board you represent?
Chris Meaden of Ferry Board. Andrew Davis from Canton Board.
Pat Cleary from Devon Tranmere Ward.
Steve Babbs, Claude Moore.
Joe Moore, Birkenhead Constituency Manager.
I'm Lauren McLaughlin and Rock Ferry Ward.
Mark Hartman from Committee Services.
Ken Abraham, Senior Solicitor.
Tony Law, the Creighton Ward.
Denise Ruby, Creighton Ward.
Phil Davis, Birkenhead and Tranmere.
Thanks very much, everybody. Those of you who've got an agenda, and I hope you all have, minutes of the last meeting, which was held on 5th of October, on pages 1 to 14. Can I ask members to agree that the record of that meeting?
So moved, Chair.
Thank you. Seconded?
Seconded.
Thank you very much. Okay. I'm going to move on. If, with permission of the committee, I'm going to vary the agenda a little bit this evening. We've got a presentation first from Mohammed Mustafir from the Dean's Centre. We're going to take that first. Following that, we're going to have questions from the public. We've got quite a few questions tonight, and I'd like to get those done with. And then we've got two more presentations, one from Katie Wilkinson from Police, and another one from Matthew Patrick. But Mohammed, would you like to come forward and start your presentation first? Thank you so much.
I don't have any pictures on the computer, but you just have to put up with me speaking for a bit. Some of you may know me, some of you may not know me. My name is Mohammed, and I'm born and brought up locally, and I work for Involved Northwest as a community connector. So I have a dual role in the community. The Widow Dean Centre has been set up in the community, and it's to really community cohesion, to bring the communities together. And we really focus ourselves on being an outreach project, where we go out, we help the community, and we bring the communities together. We function as a centre in the community, and we also function as a mosque as well. So the back end of our centre is a mosque, the front we use as the back end of the centre is used as a mosque, and the front end is used as a centre. Some of the projects that we are currently involved in at the moment, since the World Dean Centre has been set up, is every Sunday we put on a meal for the homeless, and that is in joint partnership with fans supporting food banks. And we also have the Birkenhead Scouts that operate from here 3 days a week. We have the community connectors are here as well, they're based here to help people in the community. But the Widow Dean Centre, we're just here for the community to break down barriers. We've noticed as growing up in Birkenhead, there are a lot of people who just are not aware of different cultures, and people are not aware of what Muslims are all about and what we do. And this is why a group of us have got together and we've got the Widow Dean Centre formed. Well, our main lead on the Widow Dean Centre is a head teacher, Ibrahim Said, who will say a bit more about the centre because I'm a bit lost for words at the moment. So can we welcome Ibrahim Said?
Thank you. Just to clarify, I'm not quite a head teacher, I'm a deputy head teacher. So I am a school teacher by profession, and
head teacher in the school in Warrington. Now, again, like Mohammed, I'm also locally born and raised. And I think just, you know, just to elaborate on some of the things that Mohammed said, we, in 2016, we felt the need to set something up. And what motivated us really was being from this area, but also being Muslims. And what Islam teaches us is to enrich the community and the people around us. So that is the kind of core motivation. Now, just as Mohammed was saying, part of our vision, a very strong part of our vision, was about creating a community hub which everyone could come to and connect to. So that feels like tonight. So I'm very proud and privileged to host everyone tonight. So, you know, the fact that Willow Council has recognised us as, you know, a worthy organisation to come to and to work with is it means great things to us, because just, you know, a few months ago we were dead out of the shop, there was barely any lights, it was quite a state. And what really makes an organisation is the people and the hearts that go into it. And I feel that, you know, especially looking around this table, all of the people that supported us in our endeavours have really helped us go strength to strength. I'd also want to say a special thanks to our local councillors, Councillor Jean and Councillor Phil, who actually nominated us for the award, the Whittle Award, 2017. And I'm very humbled and privileged to say that we actually were awarded that award for 2017. We're bringing communities together, and they said that, you know, we're acting as a role model for the rest of the community. So, very privileged on that. I won't say too much more. I just want to elaborate on a few more points. We also host regular events, Islamic events, where people can come and learn about our faith. So during Ramadan, we had many of you attended. We had a Taste Ramadan, Share Food, Share Friendship, and we had about 300 people attend on that occasion. We've had different events in light of the tragic event in Manchester last summer. We had a public solidarity meeting, which again was very well attended. We've had events for Eid and various other events where people have just come to those events. We work with local churches, so we've got a very strong relationship with the Diocese of Chester, which of course covers our area. So we work with the Christ Church in High Beverton in particular. We've been there to jointly deliver Sunday services. We've very recently formed a relationship with Tramier Rovers just last Friday. Mr. Mr. Harrison here. We're also very well connected with Liverpool and Everton Football Club. Their fan support and food banks have been instrumental in helping us reach out to the community. And I know in Bethnal we do have a problem with people living on the streets. So at the weekend, we're the only place open on a Sunday to provide a meal for our homeless community. In support of that, Carpenters Solicitors, they've also supported us financially to help with that. So there's lots of players involved in this. So it's not just us as the Willow Dean Centre. It really is about, as we say, serving the community and everybody working with us to make Willow a better place. And that sounds a bit cliche, doesn't it? What else was I going to say? We've also just this week we've secured a training workshop for employed people, and so just later this month we're going to be hosting some IT workshops for local people who are trying to get on the employment ladder. We work with local primary and secondary schools. Our imam, our head imam Fahmid, has gone to lots of primary schools to give assemblies. Just next week on the 6th of March, Birkenhead Girls' School are coming with 72 Year 9 girls, and I know what that feels like. So, you know, we're trying to do as much as we can with as many people as we can. But of course, we are a functioning mosque, and with that, of course, we offer the 5-day prayers, Quran classes, the Friday prayers, Ramadan prayers, and all those sorts of things. But again, I just want to extend this welcome to you all. Thank you for coming, and I hope that we can work together more in the future. I haven't mentioned my special friend, Peg Wilkinson, who is Sergeant of the local community police. a very special friendship there, and who's been instrumental actually in building these connections with Joe and of course, you know, etc. Okay, so thank you very much.
Just like to add on that, the centre is available to be used for meetings, for events, for anybody. They want to look at it as if it's your centre, not ours, it's everyone's centre, so it is welcome to be used for different events and different meetings that you may need during the year. And it's pretty much about the whole board, so morning and evening.
And you could take questions if there are any.
Yeah.
Thank you both very much again for your time. Right, so the next item on the agenda, as I said, I'm very interested. We're going to take questions from the public now. And I've had a number, I've had eight. There are several on two topics, really, and there's one or two others as well. So I think for the sake of clarity, we'll group the questions into. The first ones I'm going to take are concerning rural growth. And we've got a Mr. Phil Simpson over here. Right, stand up, Mr. Phil Simpson. And could you tell us, just for the sake of interest, what ward you're from, please? Just
well, I'm from Woodville West.
Oh, right, okay.
First time I've been to Birkenhead constituency meeting.
Okay. If you would just like to read your question out, and then ask the next person who asked a question as well, and then at the end, we'll give you an answer. Everybody will also get what you've written answer to their question, in addition to the
This first question, we've got two on the list.
All right, we'll just...
The first question is related to the Wirral Growth Company. And the question is this: what due diligence has the council done on new developments being the preferred developer for the Wirral Growth Company and Morgan Sindall Construction Company, in the wake of both companies being involved previously in boroughs where social cleansing has taken place? What guarantees will the council give that any homes demolished will be replaced with like-for-like properties, especially in our deprived areas such as Horton, Seacup, Birkenhead and New Ferry, as per Labour Party policy on the housing crisis?
Okay, thank you, Mr. Simpson. Mr. Tim Watson, are you here?
I don't think he's here tonight.
Not here. I'll read his question out, then I'll go on. There's another question, I think, from around Rural Growth. Mr. Watson has said, has the council sought to engage smaller local firms by breaking up the Rural Growth Company project into smaller parts to allow such local firms to bid? That would surely help local businesses and benefit Wirral more. Under the present agreement, no matter how many local firms are engaged, 50% of the profit goes to Moose Developments or Morgan Sindall, a national construction company, and therefore leave Wirral. But as I say, we're going to group these and you're going to get a generic answer to the Wirral Growth one, but Mr. Watson will get a particular answer in writing to his question. And let me see where there is another one. Question seven is from Stephanie Miller. Okay, her question is, government has to bail out the now defunct Carillion Company. Who will bail out the people in Wirral should the Wirral Growth Company collapse under a mountain of debt? Now, Phil, do you want to address
that? Yeah, I'm happy to address those questions. In terms of the question asked by Mr. Simpson, I can assure him that as part of the OJU competitive dialogue procurement process, extensive due diligence has been done of the preferred partner, Muse Developments. That has been rigorous and has been done by independent legal advisors. So I'm absolutely confident that due diligence has been done. And in terms of the second part of his question, I think he's wrong. I've got no evidence that either Muse or Morgan Sindall has been involved in any kind of, he's called it social cleansing. I don't know what the evidence for that is.
I didn't say that.
I didn't interrupt you.
And I don't take questions back.
No. So I don't think that's right. And I think in any case, with the joint venture partnership that we've got with Muse, it's a 50-50 partnership, and in effect, we have the council will have a veto on any deal that's been done. And then the final point to make is this is not predominantly a housing project. This is an extensive regeneration project involving commercial, retail, some residential. But there won't be any. If he's equating it with boroughs like Haringey, there won't be any demolition of existing estates or housing. Any housing that will be built will be new housing. So I don't think it's comparable with some of the examples he's making up in mind.
Okay, thank you, and you will get full written answer back. Now, the next group of questions, and I think I'm going to put number four, Annabelle Underwood, and number three, Tim Watson's not here. He's asked another question, and it's about housing in Band H properties. I think they're both related to questions we have result, really. So if we just go through those, we know Tim Watson isn't here, but I will, and George Davis has actually provided a written answer to that question. Annabelle Underwood, are you here? No? Annabelle says, the Labour Manifesto pledges to ensure housing is about homes for the many, not investment opportunities for the few. So why is Rural Council lending a developer £26 million to build 160 Band H houses worth at least 320,000 homes in Wirral West when the money would be more beneficial spent on affordable houses in this constituency? And then we've got a question for Graham Turner. Are you here? And this is, the golfing fraternity in Wirral is well catered for as the borough has golf courses dotted all around the area. Given that the sport generally is in decline, why do Wirral Council think that this is a good idea to proceed with the Hoylake Golf Resort, and how will it benefit the area? Don't we have more important things to spend money on? Phil Simpson, your question, do you want to read it out? Okay. I know you're from Wirral West now, so thank you.
Yeah. With the due diligence now carried out on the Nicholas Joint Venture Group, this is to do with the golf resort, as you say, and the Nicholas Joint Venture Group are they preferred developers. Will the leader, Phil Davis, guarantee the Wirral taxpayers that the Nicholas Joint Venture Group will not dissolve or go into liquidation? Furthermore, will he advise the taxpayers of Wirral how much interest will be charged against the loan of £26 million to the group which he intends to borrow, then loan to the Nicholas Joint Venture Group?
And we've got another one from Ken Barnes.
Yep.
Would you like to tell us what this is for? Wirral West.
The recent collapse of Carillion has left the new Royal Liverpool Hospital in disarray. The Labour NEC has recently voted to call on Haringey Council to pause its controversial 50-50 joint venture vehicle, which has been criticised for social cleansing. Despite a Europe-wide search, the only developer that could be found to take on the Hoylake Golf Resort project was a developer with a history of bankruptcy and a zero credit limit. The golf resort is to be funded by building Band-Aid houses and not social housing. Labour Party policy now prohibits the transfer of public land to private developers and flawed joint venture vehicles. How much of publicly owned land will be transferred to the private partners of the Wirral Growth Company, and do the councillors believe that the Hoylake Golf Resort and the Wirral Growth Company plans won't end up in the same mess as the Royal Hospital and Haringey?
Yeah, I'll start with that, that last one. This is a completely different project than Haringey. You know, anybody who tries to equate what we're doing on Wirral with Haringey is completely wider markets, for the reasons I've mentioned in the answer to the last question. No public assets will be transferred to any private sector company. All public assets will continue to be owned by Wirral Council. So nothing will be sold off. I'm confident that it won't have the same, it's not the same as Haringey. And let me just kind of say a little bit about why we're looking at these kind of deals. We're looking at these kind of deals because effectively the government is slashing Wirral Council's budget by a massive amount, £170 million since 2010, another £130 million by 2021. And the revenue support grant, which is the biggest block of money that historically local authorities have relied on from central government, will disappear entirely by 2021. So if we don't replace that money that's going from our budget by new income, we'll effectively go bankrupt. And some of you have may have read about a ironically, Tory-controlled council, Northamptonshire County Council, which is just exactly in that position. They have literally gone bankrupt because they didn't make provision for new income. They used all of their reserves, and the problem with reserves is once you use them, they're gone. So I don't want to be in a position in 3 years' time when effectively all our external funding is gone by telling the residents of Boro we'll have to close down services because we haven't made provision for replacing that lost money. So the growth company and will bring in a revenue stream to the council for the next 10 years. The golf resort, and let me just remind the audience that the golf resort has not been agreed yet. We have agreed to do a number of feasibility studies over the next year, funded by the developer, into whether it's the environmental impact, the traffic impact, the economic impact. We will get you're shaking your head, that's exactly what we all do.
Well, yeah, no,
Mr. Simpson, will you sit down,
and we will await the outcome of those feasibility studies before we take it to the next stage. But I think we'd be failing in our duty if we didn't look at a project that would bring in near on £1 million a year for the council in business rates and council tax receipts that we could use to fund social services, leisure services, highways and all the vital services we rely on, and provide 175 direct jobs and 168 construction jobs. Yeah, I think we'd be mad if we just if didn't even look at the evidence as to whether that was feasible. So, I think it's a sensible decision to wait until we've looked at the outcomes of all those studies before we decide whether we're going to press ahead. And that's what we've committed to do, and no more at the moment. So that's my response to Mr. Barnes. Right, the other one, I think Moira was...
There's a couple about Band-Aid properties, which you've addressed income.
I mean, the issue about Band-Aid properties, the reason why we are... the reason why the local government funding system is so unfair is that it penalises those local authorities, like Wirral, with most of its properties in the lower council tax bands, A and B. So therefore, a 1% increase in our council tax raises much less than local authorities with more housing in the higher council tax bands. So Wirral generates something like 1.3 million from a 1% increase in council tax. Compare that to Westminster Council in the south that generates probably hundreds of millions for a 1% increase. So we need to encourage more of the higher council tax band properties because that brings vital income into the council's coffers to fund public services going on. I think that was the point that George Davis was making in response to that issue.
Then there's questions about due diligence having been done on joint venture. What about the interest being charged against the loan?
Okay, so if the Hoylake Golf Resort goes ahead, and I emphasise we're still at feasibility stage, the proposal is to charge a 5% rate of interest, which will generate 2.5 million, again, which will go into the council's coffers to provide, to help us fund public services going forward.
The other one is a very broad one, which basically says how will the golf resort benefit the area? Well, I think you've dealt with that.
Try to go through some of that.
Okay. The next question I'm going to take is from Karen O'Rourke. Are you here, Karen? Karen, yes, it's got him.
A recent World Health Organization study found that the air pollution in Birkenhead exceeds safety levels. In a recent High Court ruling, a judge branded the current government policy unlawful and has ordered local authorities to do more and to take action as soon as possible. Air pollution kills thousands every year. What steps will the council take to improve air pollution levels in Birkenhead? And do the councillors think that the council should now scrap its plan to spend millions on new roads for a golf resort just a few miles downwind of Birkenhead?
I think that question has been answered already. We've got to the
issue about the golf resort.
Okay.
An environmental impact assessment is one of the key studies that we're doing as part of the feasibility of the next stage, and that will cover the issue of air pollution. So I think these are independent studies, not funded by the council, funded by the developer, that will be made available to the public for scrutiny and for challenge.
And Karen, sorry, I neglected to ask you where you're from. What ward are you from?
Rural West.
Rural West, okay, thank you. I'm not sure that any of us are equipped to answer the question on the air pollution and what the council is doing, but we will get a written answer to you from the cabinet member in the evening. I think then the last question is one that covers everything really, and that's from Lily Flood. Are you here, Lily?
I'm here.
Would you mind telling me where you're from?
I'm from Wirral West as well.
Right, well, a lot from Wirral West.
I wonder why.
Would you like to read your question out? It's quite long. I think some of the points have probably already been addressed in previous answers given, but he makes a point in general about regeneration of heart and broken head, which is something which we all are told in fear and are really, really keen to see. It's a really imaginative project.
The closure of Marks and Spencer's is another blow for Birkenhead and a further indictment of Wirral Council's failure to support Wirral's main town centre over several decades. Notwithstanding the very recent announcement of the Wirral Growth Company, there has been a chronic need for serious investment in Birkenhead for many years. In the light of this, why in recent years has Wirral Council ploughed over £1 million into the deeply unpopular golf resort executive housing development proposal for Hoylake, especially as the leader of the council has recently said that there is a national downturn in the amount of people playing golf. This is leading to a huge shortfall in fees collected at public golf courses in Wirral. Does the council accept that the chronic need for investment in Birkenhead means that further waste of resources to promote the Hoylake Golf Resort is totally unacceptable to the vast majority of people in Birkenhead and throughout Wirral?
Yeah, well said.
My response to that is the challenge of investing in Birkenhead is exactly why we set up the Wirral Growth Company. Because Birkenhead Town Centre is one of the key priority areas. And over the next 18 months, the plans are to invest huge resources into improving the offer in Birkenhead Town Centre. And the project that is dear to my heart, the one I keep quoting, is a new market. I mean, you know, I've said many times when I was a kid, people used to come from miles around to go to the market. It needs a massive upgrade. The plans for the growth company and the town centre in Birkenhead includes a new market, but lots of other new facilities as well, and opening up the precinct. So it's precisely because we've got the challenges of the need to spend significant amounts of money in the town centre that we've set up the growth company. Council can't do it on our own. We have not got the resources. So I don't think this is an either or. I think we need to look at projects like the golf resort, which incidentally is not just to attract people who play golf, but it will be a, if it comes to fruition, a destination in its own right. And it will hold conferences there and all sorts of other income generation ideas. But I don't think it's an either or. I think we need to do both, primarily because Moira, as I said earlier on, if we don't look at how we can bring new income streams into the council, this council will run out of money. And I don't want to be in the same position as Tory-controlled Northamptonshire, because I haven't provided for that lost money. You can only use reserves once. Borrowing just creates more debts that we have to fund through cuts. So for me, it's a logical thing to do. We need to look at opportunities. But Birkenhead Town Centre, I think certainly on the Labour side, we are all committed to investing significant additional investment, and the growth company is the mechanism to do that. If we don't do that, I don't know what the alternative is, because I absolutely accept that we can't let it continue to not have that investment. So this is an opportunity of a lifetime, really, and we need to grasp it because we all want to see the offer improve in both.
And that's the end of questions now, but I just would like to say that the councillors on the Wirral, Labour group of councillors on the Wirral, are very strongly behind these projects, particularly the Wirral Grove, and really believe that this is the imaginative way forward for the centre of Birkenhead, and particularly. But that's the end of public questions now. And Katie, do you want to come do your presentation? Thank you very much, everybody. Katie's going to talk to us about initiatives for promoting community cohesion in the Woodlands area of Birkenhead.
I am the local policing community sergeant for Birkenhead Tranmere Ward and the Oxton Wards. I have responsibility for reducing crime and ASB in those areas and to sort of generally make it a nice place to live if you're a resident from a policing point of view. As you may already be aware, there are a number of issues affecting Birkenhead. As I put up there, we've got quite high rates of drug and alcohol misuse, which sadly you will see at times if you walk around Birkenhead. We have some issues with youth-related antisocial behaviour, and more recently we've become aware of some issues about unreported hate crime and the issues that causes as well. And finally, a number of different communities live alongside each other in Birkenhead, but there's very, very little interaction between those community groups, notwithstanding the work that's done here, which I will come on to a little bit later on. Quite often I see from a policing point of view, my staff will attend community groups and it will be a residents association, and then we will attend another group within sort of a religious organisation. We might not necessarily get all the people together, yet they all suffer the same problems and they all suffer the same needs and they all want the same thing, and it's somewhere to live where there's no crime and no antisocial behaviour and where it's a nice place to live. With regards to the high rates of drug and alcohol misuse, we've already done quite a lot of work in Birkenhead Town Centre over the last 12 months with regards to street drinking and the cumulative impact policy, which reduces the availability. That prevents further properties from obtaining licences unless they can prove that they aren't going to be impact on the cumulative impact of alcohol in that area. So basically, it's a bit like an antisocial behaviour order for licensed premises. What we've said is that a very small part of Birkenhead, we've got quite a lot of off licences, please can we not have any more? That's something that the council brought in last year, and it is positive because it's helped us reject an application for further licence within the Birkenhead area, which is an area that suffers with street drinking. With regards to the drug dealing, I get updates from the community with regards to drug dealing in and around this area and the impact that it has. You know, I'm a mother of small children and I don't want my children to have to walk past that, and I wouldn't expect somebody else to have to do the same with their children. So it's for us, it's about getting the community involved and letting us know where the problems are so that we can direct our resources. With regards to the youth-related antisocial behaviour, for those of you that don't know the area very well, just opposite the car park where you come out of the pyramids, there's a small park area there. That's just up the road from a school called the Woodlands Primary School. This part of Birkenhead has quite a thriving ethnic community. It's got a large number of people who come from Southeast Asian backgrounds, living alongside local community members whose families have lived here for generations as well. When those children are in school, everything goes really, really well and everything's fine. But when you get those children outside of school, the children that might play alongside each other in the playground get different messages sometimes at home. And we are getting reports of hate crime and actually some of the children being told you can't play in this park because you're not white, which is something that we don't want, so we're taking some steps to tackle. And then as I've already said, we've got those communities that live alongside each other but don't necessarily have that regular interaction. I've been coming to the Dean Centre now through my role in work probably about a year now, just over a year. As a result of being here, I've seen the impact that it's had on the community and it's the positive effect that it's had. It's just letting people realise that different communities and different backgrounds, although they may appear different on the outside, you know what, your values are very much the same. When you sit and you listen to sort of the people talking at the, it was at the youth festival when we talked about that, and the imams got up and talked, very much similar to the sermon that you would get in your church, and it was really good to see local community members who wouldn't necessarily be exposed to that, be invited in to come in and have some food, and to see that, and to see that, actually, do you know what, we're all very much the same. Okay. What will we do? I put we as a very global thing. It's not just Merseyside Police, I'm talking about some other things that we'll do. One of the things we do need to do is identify and manage our offenders who commit antisocial behaviour and are believed to be committing the hate crime. As a result of the information I received about unreported hate crime instances occurring in Birkenhead, I have set up something called the Problem Solving Group, which is a police-led group, but we invite members from across the community and from across different organisations. So, for example, Joe comes and sits along some of the meetings, and Bo, who was here earlier as a community connector, he's been invited to come to the meetings as well. And then all the people, as I can see Mark in the background over there, lots of people have been brought in, so people from Wirral Change, local schools, to try and solve this problem that we've got, where we've got young people who don't feel comfortable using a park that's actually a park in their own. Another thing that we've also done is invited registered social landlords along to those meetings as well, because we have information sharing agreements with them, so that we can tackle a joint approach. If we identify the people that are causing these problems, then we can use a multi-agency approach to deal with that, be it gather evidence to support criminal behaviour orders, or whether or not we look at enforcing tenancy legislation so that if somebody's causing antisocial behaviour in a privately owned property, then having that contact with the private landlord to say, your tenant's causing this antisocial behaviour, manage your tenant or we will seek a closure order on your property. We are starting to have those conversations with people and their landlords that we've identified as being responsible for that antisocial behaviour. I've also put up here about policing by consent. I think in Britain we've got quite a proud history of policing by consent. We go by the Pelian principles of saying that actually we police with your consent. But then in effect what that means is you have to tell us what your problems are and then we work with you to solve them. If we don't get that feedback from the community, we can't solve the problems. If you don't tell me where you think somebody is dealing drugs or the registration number of that car or the name of that person, it reduces my ability to be able to deal with that and target my resources to go and deal with that. Also, improved community cohesion does increase and improve standard of living. It does, it makes things better. I know when I first came here and I met with Ibrahim and some of the other gents, I talked about the fact that within some of my communities I was aware of racist beliefs, or even unconditional bias is a word that gets bandied around at the moment, and I think that's probably a good way of describing what it is. A lot of people don't understand somebody else's culture, they're different, and therefore they keep away from them and they don't want that contact with them. Places like the Dean Centre are breaking that down. We're all sat here today. I know you might have noticed when you first came in, but even in Persbrough, how many people actually would have seen that before they came here today? Probably not many. Also, that improves the community cohesion. It's all about getting the community groups together. The people that are causing the antisocial behaviour, that are causing the problems, the kids who ride the bikes, the kids who are causing the issues just as you go past the Hive Youth Zone up onto Conway Street, are the same children that are causing some of the antisocial behaviour in and around the park and some of the racial abuse. So if both communities tackle together and tell us what the problems are, then we can deal with that. But you know, if you get the communities together in a room at the same time, they realise they've got the same problem. People talk, people say, well, do you know what, little Kate did this and little Kate did that, it's the same person and let's do something about it, and that's what we're trying to get improved in. Okay, another thing that we're going to do is a letter drop to local residents, so the residents on the Woodlands estate and then the residents in and around here, just reminding them about how to contact the local police team, about what hate crime is and how we will not tolerate hate crime, and then we'll get that letter translated into Bengali as well so that local residents can read that. And then finally, future community activities. This is the nice bit that we get to do. Okay. As a result of the problem solving group that was set up, one of the actions that's come out of that meeting is to make that park an area where everybody feels that they own it. Now, I live on a different part of the Wirral, and we've got a park near to us that's really popular. The local children got involved in helping redesign it, and there's lots of events that go on in that park. Now, it's bigger than this one, but there's no reason why we can't do that on a smaller scale here, so that's what we're planning to do. The local community groups we've started having interaction with them. If we move further down, there's a funding bid that's been submitted by the Wirral Dean Centre, the Royal Multicultural Society, to get some planters in that park so that the local people can put plants in there. The plan is that we're going to have contact with the local primary schools so that children from all backgrounds can go there. And if they feel that they are involved in that park, do you know what, it reduces crime and antisocial behaviour. If young people are there involved in doing it, they're going to respect it more and they're going to want it to be a nice space, and they're more likely to challenge their peers when they do something that's unacceptable. I've also arranged for Stop Hate UK to come in and talk to some of the local residents to explain about why it's important to report hate crime to police, and also to explain about the different ways that you can report hate crime. You don't just have to do it via your local community officers or your local police. You can do it via third agencies, or you can do it online via Stop Hate UK. So hopefully that will be arranged in the next couple of weeks. Even him's given me some really, really good advice, which, thank you very much. It's been accepted. It's looking like a local school is going to be that, facilitate that so that parents could come in after afternoon prayers, and we can have that conversation with a volunteer from Stop Hate UK coming out to explain to people about what we do. We're also looking at community action days. We have them quite a lot in and around Birkenhead. Joe organises quite a lot for us, so thank you, Joe. Now, we're looking to do some of those on the Woodlands Estate and also on this surrounding area here, where it will be clean-up days for the community, door knocks, having conversations where CSOs go out and knock on doors and say, okay, what problems are affecting you? Where are your issues? What can we do? Some of it isn't a police issue, some of it does fall back to the council, some of it might not. Some of it might just be loneliness, in which case we can put people in touch with the right departments and the right places that can help. And then looking at the community fund day at the Woodlands Park, one of the things that we are looking to do in the summer, once the fund has been successful and we've got the planters in place and maybe got some new local community groups, National Citizen Scheme, isn't it, to paint the railings again, getting the young people involved. I was speaking at the Hive today, and they're really keen to let their bands come down and present to the local community, and then maybe have like an international food, sort of people try food, different foods from different areas. Birkenhead's got a really diverse community. We've actually got quite a thriving Chinese community as well, and getting all the different food, people come and then people talk when they eat. It's been going on for generations, that's what we do. So getting people involved and having fun and being in that park and reminding people that it's there to be enjoyed by the community, and that's what should happen. And also, hopefully, then the community will have the faith that if there is an issue, they can phone the police, and that we can then investigate it and take it further. And finally, I've missed off school visits. One of my constables and one of my CSOs have been involved with the Woodlands Primary School at the moment, and we're rolling it out to other schools, where we have been doing some work with the Aerial Trust, and it's a classroom-based video that we're showing young children. And it's just to explain about the different messages that sometimes you get at home regarding people from different communities where people don't necessarily understand what's going on. And then further on from that, it will show about the impact that a comment that you make. For example, some of the ladies I have spoken to who will walk through Birkenhead Town Centre